Good morning, everyone. I welcome you once again in this another session of Power System Studies, wherein we will be discussing about the AC power flow. Basically, we are going to discuss about the introduction of the AC power flow. We will discuss about the modeling of power system components and the formulation of Y buses. The references have been given to you are PowerPoint Power System Analysis by Nagaraj Kothari, and the publisher is Tata Micro Hills. Another reference is the Electrical Power System by C.L. Wadhwa, and another reference is Power System Analysis by B.R. Gupta. I will recommend this Nagaraj Kothari more rather than these other four being for the reference purpose. Now let's discuss about the load flow analysis. The load flow analysis says that the AC power flow analysis is basically a steady state analysis of AC transmission and the distribution grid. Essentially, AC power flow method computes the steady state values of bus voltages and line power flows from the knowledge of electric loads and generations at different buses of the system under the study. In this module, we will look into the power flow solution of AC transmission grid only. That is, the solution methodology of AC distribution grid will not be covered. Further, I will also discuss about the study of power flow solution techniques when an HVDC link is embedded into an AC transmission grid. Also, we will be considering only a balanced system in which the transmission lines and loads are balanced. The impedance are equal in all three phases, and the generator produces balanced three-phase voltages are equal. Basically, these the magnitudes are equal in all phases, while the angular differences between any two phases is 120 degree. Basically, the load flow analysis is nothing but the determination of voltages and other parameters, that is the voltage and an angle delta at each bus of the power system. With the knowledge of these voltage and delta, we will be able to find out the other parameters, that is the power flow from one end to the another end, along with the later we will be able to discuss or to find out the losses of the transmission lines. So By the determination of the voltages and the angles or the delta at each of the bus, we will be able to find out the other parameters. So basically, if we go with the modeling of power system components, it has different components which are connected to the grid. That is the synchronous generators, the transformers, transmission lines, and so on. For the purpose of power flow solutions, the synchronous generators are not represented explicitly, rather their presence is implicitly. We will be look into the implicit representation of synchronous generators a little later. But let's discuss the other three components modeled explicitly and their representations as flows. So first of all, let us consider the very first component, that is the load. So as we all know that the load can be categorized into the three categories. That is a constant power, okay, that's the constant impedance and constant I. So we can take as a constant PQ model, Z model, or the I model. So these are the three models, or we can say the models or the categories of the loads. ओके, तो फर्स्ट इज द कॉन्स्टेंट पावर, अनदर इज कॉन्स्टेंट इम्पिडेंस, अनदर इज अ कॉन्स्टेंट करंट. बट हाउ एवर विद इन द नॉर्मल ऑपरेटिंग रेंज ऑफ द वोल्टेजेस ऑलमोस्ट ऑल द लोड्स बिहेव एज अ कॉन्स्टेंट पावर लोड. एज द ऑब्जेक्टिव ऑफ द एसी पावर फ्लो एनालिसिस इज टू कॉम्प्यूट द नॉर्मल स्टडी स्टेट वैल्यूज ऑफ द बस वोल्टेजेस, द लोड्स आर ऑलवेज रिप्रेजेंटेड एज कॉन्स्टेंट पावर लोड. सो लुक एट दिस, कॉन्स्टेंट पावर लोड्स, दीज आर ऑलवेज रिप्रेजेंटेड बाय द कॉन्स्टेंट पावर लोड्स. हेंस एट एनी बस के, इफ यू आर अज्यूमिंग दैट अ बस के के इज अ रियल एंड रिएक्टिव पावर लोड्स आर स्पेसिफाइड एज 100 मेगावाट एंड 50 MVAR. Okay, let's, we are assuming these values. Let us assume that at a bus K, we are having the, let us this, let this be the bus K. This is one of a generator and this is like a bus K. Okay, so at this bus, the real and reactive power are 100 megawatt and 50 MVAR. Okay, we are asking. So an important point need to be mentioned over here, that as a load are always varying with respect to time. The customers, as we know that the customers are always switch on and off the loads. Any specific value of the load is valid only at a particular time instant. So hence the power flow analysis is always carried out for the loads and the generators values at a particular instant. I hope this is clear. So let us assume the another component, that is the transmission line. The another model which we are going to discuss of for the power system is the transmission line. So in a transmission grid, the transmission lines are generally medium length or a long length. We know that we have, can classify the transmission lines into three categories. That is the short, medium and the long. So in transmission grids, if you are talking about the grids, then we will be discussing only about the medium and the long. We are not going to discuss the short transmission. Transmission lines are considered whose length is less than 50 kilometers or 50. Okay, and medium transmission lines are those which are less from 50 to 150 kilometers. And above 150 kilometers, we consider them as a long transmission lines. So generally, it is being represented with the medium or the long length transmission lines. So a line of medium length is always represented by normal pi, nominal pi model, as shown in this figure. Look at this. This is the pi model, nominal pi model of a transmission line, where Z is the Z bar is the total series impedance. This is the total series impedance of the line, and BC is the total shunt charging susceptance of the line. Okay, this is your charging shunt susceptance of the line, which is being divided equally at the two ends of the section of the lines, at the two section end sections of the line. Okay, whereas on the other hand, the transmission lines which are being taken as a long transmission line are not basically been represented by its distributed parameters. Here we consider the lump parameters. Okay, whereas in this we consider the distributed parameters. Okay, so this is the way in which we do the modeling of the two transmission lines. Either one is the medium and another is the long transmission line. Now, for the steady state analysis, a long length line can be accurately represented by an equivalent pi model, which predicts the accurate behavior of the line with respect to its terminal measurement taken its into taken at its two ends. The equivalent pi model is being shown in the figure 2.2. Okay, look at this. This is an equivalent pi model of a long transmission line connected between the two terminals, two end sections, that is between the bus I and bus J. Okay. Now, where ZC is the characteristic impedance of the line. Look at this. This ZC is the characteristic impedance of the line. I think you are aware of the characteristic impedance of the line. What is the characteristic impedance? Or what is the surge impedance of the line? Okay. Now, gamma. Now, this is your characteristic impedance, which is your Z bar upon Y bar. This Z is the impedance per unit length. Impedance per unit length. And Y bar is the admittance per unit length. Per unit kilometer, if we say, on per unit kilometer. Okay. These are these two things. And ZC is your characteristic impedance. Okay. Now, this gamma is your propagation constant. This is gamma is your propagation constant, which is nothing but equal to under root Z bar into Y bar. Now, we told you that Z bar is the series impedance of the line per unit length, and Y bar is the shunt admittance of the line per unit length, and the L is the total length of the line. Hence, the power system analysis, a transmission line is always represented by a pi circuit. Okay. Now, let's discuss about the another component of the power system, that is your transformer. So, for a power system steady state, the fault studies, generally the exciting current of the transformer is neglected and is quite low, as it is very quite low compared to the normal load current flowing through the transformer, that is the rated load current flowing through the transformer. The exciting current is very small. It is up to the 2 to 5% of the rated current. So you can assume that how small values it is. Therefore, a two winding transformer connected between the bus I and J, represented by its per unit leakage impedance as shown in figure 2.3. Now, look at this diagram, figure 2.3, that equivalent circuit of the two winding transformer between the two buses I and J, and this is your per unit leakage impedance. This is your per unit leakage impedance. So it has to be noted down that the transformer tap ratio is 1:1. For a regulating transformer with a transmission ratio of 1:2T. Okay. If the transformer is of 1:1 and the regulating transformer with a transformation ratio 1:T, as shown in the figure 2.4. Look at this diagram. This is 2.4. This is your equivalent circuit for a regulating transformer. Okay. Now, it has to be noted down, sometimes a transformer ratio is also represented at A:1. In that case, the equivalent circuit is as shown in the figure 2.5. Look at over here. Okay, if the transformation ratio is that if the transformation ratio is 1:A, then the equivalent circuit will be nothing but represented, the T will be replaced by 1/A. Now, please note that the figure 2.4 and 5, the quantities T and A are real. That is, the transformer is changing only the voltage magnitude, not its angle. Further, in these two figures, the quantity Y bar is the per unit length impedance of the transformer. It's the per unit admittance of the transformer. Also, figure 2.5 can be derived from figure 2.4 by nothing, by replacing T is equal to 1/A, which as I have stated. Now, with the models of above components in place, we are now in a position to start systematic study of an N bus power system. Now, towards that goal, we first must understand the concept of injected power, injected current, which is our next topic. Now, let's discuss the concept of injected power and current. Now, as the name suggests, the injected power, or we can say the current specifically, we inject the current, indicates the power current which is fed into a bus. To understand this concept, let us consider this figure 2.6 in a part A of this figure. A generator is connected to the bus. Look at this figure 2.6. A generator is connected and it is injecting a real and reactive power generated by the generator. Okay. At this K, both supplying both a real and reactive power to the bus, and thus the injected real and reactive power are taken to be real or reactive power supplied by the generator. Okay. The real and reactive power supplied by the generator. Let it be the bus number K. Okay. Now, hence a corresponding injected current is also taken to be equal to the current supplied by the generator. Whereas on the other hand, for the load connected to the bus K, as shown in the figure 2, the physically real and reactive power consumed by the load. This is the load. Excuse me. Now, look at this load. This load is connected to a bus K, for an example. Now, this load is consuming the real and reactive power, L defining the load. Okay, so the power consumed by the load flows away from the bus. And thus, the injected real and reactive power is taken to be negative. Okay, here we are taking the injected real and reactive power to be considering as a positive. But here, it is consuming the real and reactive power from the bus. So that's why it is considered to be negative. I hope this is clear to you. Now, similarly, the corresponding injected current IK is also taken as negative of the load current. If both the generators and the load are connected at particular bus as depicted in this figure. If both are connected to a single, then the net injected real reactive power supplied to the bus is equal to the generator real reactive power minus the real or reactive power consumed by the load. Okay. So if the net supplied to this bus, the net supplied to this bus is equal to PG minus PL and QG minus QL. If this is the load, if it is the real and reactive power demanded by the load, okay, that has to be subtracted by this, and the net power will be supplied to the bus K. Okay, and thus in this case, the current injected current be the difference of the generator and the load current. I think this has been cleared. Now, when we are considering the generator, the power is supplying towards the bus and it is taken as positive. In the case of load, if the power is supplying from bus to the load, moving away from the load bus, that's why it is taken as negative. And in this case, the net difference will be taken as a positive towards the bus. Okay. Now to summarize this, if I would say that PK and QK, if this PK and QK and this IK denotes the injected real power, the reactive power, and the complex current at the bus K. Okay. Now, in that case, if the PK is equal to PG and QK is equal to QG and IK is equal to IG, if only a generator is connected to the bus, that is the case one. Okay. Now, if the power Pk is negative, now look at this. If the power is taken as negative and the Qk is also negative and the current is also is negative, that means the load is connected at the bus K. That is your case two. Now, next case is if Pk is equal to Pg minus PL, Qk is equal to Qg minus QL, Ik is equal to Ig minus AL. In this case, both the generators and loads are connected to the bus K. And the third, fourth case is when the Pk is equal to 0, Qk is equal to 0 and current are 0. That is the neither the generator nor the load is connected at the bus K. Okay. So with this concept, the injected power and current, we are now in a position to start the analysis of any general N bus power system. The first step towards this goal is to derive the bus admittance matrix, which we'll be discussing in the next slides. Okay. Look at this. Now look at about the formation of bus admittance matrix by bus. Let us consider a 5-bus network as shown in figure 2.7. Look at this figure 2.7. Consider this a 5-bus network where this is a bus number 1, bus number 2, bus number 3, 4 and 5. Okay. Now, in this network, all the transmissions are represented by pi models, it has been assumed. Here, we are not able to see the transmission lines as a pi model, but we are assuming that the transmission lines are being connected in a pi model. Therefore, the equivalent circuit of the above figure is being shown in figure 2.8. If you draw the equivalent circuit of this above network, it will be like this. Look at this. Now look at this. This is the transmission line. This is a T1 for an example. This is it will be better to represent it with T23. Okay. It is T24. It is your T34. Okay. Now look at this. We are representing this with that pi model. This Y23 with the shunt and this is series admittance. These are your shunt admittance with the pi model. Okay. Similarly, this is your Y24. This is your Y34. Okay. This is your transformer T2. Okay. And this is your transformer T1. Okay. Now, in this figure, let K is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Are injected currents at the bus K. Okay. At the bus K, for the 5 buses, we are injecting the currents. Okay. Further, the quantity YIJ denotes that the series admittance of the line IJ, whereas the quantity YIJS denotes the half line charging susceptance of the line of IJ. Now, if you apply the KCL at the node K, then we will obtain this equation number 2.1. It states that the I1 is equal to Y bar T1 into V1 minus V2, that difference between the bus 2, 1 and 2, and YT1 V1 minus Y bar T1 into V2. Okay. Look at this. For this section of line of this power system. Okay, the current I1 is injected at bus number 1, I2 is injected at bus number 2, I3 is injected at bus number 3, I5 bar is injected at bus number 5, and I4 is injected at over here. Okay. Now similarly, I can write it for the current I2, I3, I4, and I5 as we have written it for the current I1. Is this clear? Now, when we represent this in a matrix form, I can write it as I1, I2, I3, I4 and I5 will be equal to Y11, Y12, Y13, Y14, Y15. That means we are going to make a 5 cross 5 matrix. 5 rows and 5 columns. Okay, is this clear? And over here, we will be getting a V1, V2, V3, V4 and V5. Now, what are these capital Y11? What is this capital Y11? So, look at these. These are the called as the these are Y11, Y22, Y33, Y44 and Y55. Okay. These are the diagonal elements and these are the off diagonal elements. Y12, Y13, Y21, Y31, Y32. So what is about the Y11? The Y11 is your just admittance of the transformer T1. Okay. Look at this diagram. Okay. This is the Y11 is the admittance of the transformer T1 associated with the bus 1. Which admittance is connected? This admittance is connected. Okay. Now Y12 is minus of YT1. Now Y12. Now when we are writing it with the 1 to 2, that means we are moving from 1 to 2. We will be taking this as a negative. We will always take the off diagonal elements as a negative one, as a negative polarity. Okay, over here. Why it is coming over here? Look at this. Again, you can see. Look at this equation. It is coming to be what? YT1 minus of YT1. Is this clear? When we are dealing it with the I1 and V2. Okay, look at this over here again. When we are dealing with I1 and V2. This will be what? I1 is equal to Y12 into V2. Isn't it? So the associated element with this Y12 is what? Minus of YT1. Now similarly, we can write it for the other. We can write it for all the other parameters. And we will write this complete matrix into the I bus matrix is equal to Y bus matrix into the V bus matrix. Okay. So what we have done, we have injected the current at each of the buses. We have applied the KVL, and then we have applied the we have completed the equations for each of the bus and transformed into a matrix form, and the matrix elements are being taken as a Y11, Y12, which is corresponding with respect to the equations which we have developed. And finally, we have written it in a short form, that is of I bus is equal to Y bus into the V bus. I hope this is clear to you. Now, look at this further, that I bus is equal to I1, I2, I5 transpose. We have done the transpose of this. That is a 5 cross 1 is a vector of bus injections currents. V bus is what? 5 cross 1 is a vector of bus voltage measured with respect to the ground. And Y bus is a 5 cross 5 bus admittance matrix. This is your bus admittance matrix. Y bus is what? This is your bus admittance matrix. Now furthermore, from the elements of Y bus, it can be observed that I is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. The number of buses we are having in the system. And if we are representing this YII, here we were having the Y11, okay, Y22, Y33, Y44, Y55. So basically, these are the sum of the total of all the admittances connected at bus I. Look at this diagram again. How many admittances are connected at bus number 1? Only one, that is this one. How many admittances are connected at bus number 2? YT1, Y23, okay, and Y24. So look at this. Was Y21, Y23, Y23S, Y23, Y24S, and Y24. We are having the two susceptance admittance as well. Okay, that's why it is shown over here. Is this clear? Now, Yij, that is your 1, 2, or 2, 3, or 3, 4 are the negative of the admittance connected between the bus I and bus J. If these two buses are physically connected with each other, if the two buses are not physically connected, for an example, bus number 1 and bus number 5 are not directly physically connected. You can say that bus number 1 is directly physically connected with the bus number 5. So the associated elements with the bus Y15, that is the Y15 and Y51 will be what? It equal to 0. Look at over here. Y15 is equal to 0. Y51 is equal to 0. Similarly, the 2 and 5 are also not connected. That's why it is equal to 0. 1 and 5, 1 and 4 are not connected directly. 1 and 3 are not connected directly. Okay. So that's why they are a 0. Okay. If there is no physical connection. If there is a physical connection, then it will be the negative of the admittance connected to the bus number I and bus number J. I hope this is clear to you. If you have any doubts, then you can drop your questions and queries in the comment section. We will solve it as soon as possible. Now, similarly, for an N bus power system, this is for the 5 bus power system. Now, if we are having the N bus power system, then this relationship equation 2.7 holds very satisfied. That is where I bus is equal to, it is n cross 1 vector. V bus will be equal to n cross 1, and y bus will be equal to n cross n bus admittance matrix. Okay. Now, the elements of the y bus matrix are calculated in same way as described above in the previous section, in the previous example we have seen. So far, we have considered the formation of y bus matrix where there is no mutual coupling among the elements of the network. Yes, if there may be a mutual coupling between the two elements. Okay, so we have neglected the mutual coupling right now. So in the next lecture, we will see the procedure forming the Y-bus matrix in the presence of mutual coupling between the elements. Elements are represented by pi models. It has been assumed. Here we are not able to see the transmission lines as a pi model, but we are assuming that the transmission lines are being connected in a pi model. Therefore, the equivalent circuit of the above figure is being shown in figure 2.8. If you draw the equivalent circuit of this above network, it will be like this. Look at this. Now look at this. This is the transmission line. This is a T1 for an example. This is T. It will be better to represent it with T23. Okay. It is T. 2-4. It is your T-3-4. Okay. Now look at this. We are representing this with that pi model. This Y-2-3. With that shunt admittance. This is series admittance. These are your shunt admittance with the pi model. Okay. Similarly, this is your Y-2-4. This is your Y-3-4. Okay. This is your transformer T2. Okay. And this is your transformer T1. Okay. Now, in this figure, let K is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 are injected currents at the bus K. Okay. At the bus K, for the 5 buses, we are injecting the currents. Okay. Further, the quantity YIJ denotes that the series admittance of the line IJ, whereas the quantity YIJS denotes the half line charging susceptance of the line of IJ. Now, if you apply the KCL at the node K, then we will obtain this equation number 2.1. It states that the I1 is equal to Y bar T1 into V1 minus V2, that difference between the bus 2, 1 and 2, and YT1, V1 minus y bar t1 into v2. Okay, look at this. For this section of line of this power system, okay, the current I1 is injected at bus number 1, I2 is injected at bus number 2, I3 is injected at bus number 3, I5 bar is injected at bus number 5, and I4 is injected at over here. Okay, now similarly, I can write it for the current I2, I3, I4, and I5 as we have written it for the current I1. Is this clear? Now, when we represent this in a matrix form, I can write it as I1, I2, I3, I4, and I5 will be equal to Y11, Y12, Y13, Y14, Y15. That means we are going to make a 5 cross 5 matrix. 5 rows and 5 columns. Okay, is this clear? And over here, we will be getting a V1, V2, V3, V4, and V5. Now, what are these capital Y11? What is this capital Y11? So, look at these. These are the called as the... These are Y11, Y22, Y33, Y44, and Y55. Okay? These are the diagonal elements. And these are the off diagonal elements. Y12, Y13, Y21, Y31, Y32. So what is about the Y11? The Y11 is the admittance of the transformer T1. Okay, look at this diagram. Okay. This is the Y11 is the admittance of the transformer T1 associated with the bus 1. Which admittance is connected? This admittance is connected. Okay. Now Y12 is minus of YT1. Now Y12. Now when we are writing it with the 1 to 2, then that means we are moving from 1 to 2. We will be taking this as a negative. We will always take the off diagonal elements as a negative one, as a negative polarity. Okay, over here. Why it is coming over here? Look at this. Again, you can see. Look at this equation. It is coming to be what? Y T1 minus of Y T1. Is this clear? When we are dealing it with the I1 and V2. Okay, look at this over here again. When we are dealing with I1 and V2. This will be what? I1 is equal to Y12 into V2. Isn't it? So the associated element with this Y12 is what? Minus of YT1. Now similarly, we can write it for the other. We can write it for all the other parameters, and we will write this complete matrix into the I bus matrix is equal to Y bus matrix into the V bus matrix. Okay, so what we have done, we have injected the current at each of the buses. We have applied the KVL, and then we have applied we have completed the equations for each of the bus and transformed into a matrix form, and the matrix elements are being taken as a Y11, Y12, which is corresponding with respect to the equations which we have developed. And finally, we have written it in a short form, that is of I bus is equal to Y bus into the V bus. I hope this is clear to you. Now, look at this further, that I bus is equal to I1, I2, I5 transpose. We have done the transpose of this. That is a 5 cross 1. Is a vector of bus injections currents. V bus is what? 5 cross 1 is a vector of bus voltage measured with respect to the ground. And Y bus is a 5 cross 5 bus admittance matrix. This is your bus admittance matrix. Y bus is what? This is your bus admittance matrix. Now, furthermore, from the elements of YBUS, it can be observed that I is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, the number of buses we are having in the system. And if we are representing it by II, here we were having the Y11, okay, Y22, Y33, Y44, Y55. So basically, these are the sum of the total of all the admittances connected at bus I. Look at this diagram again. How many admittances are connected at bus number 1? Only one, that is this one. How many admittances are connected at bus number 2? YT1, Y23, okay, and Y24. So look at this. It was YT1, Y23S, Y23, Y24S, and Y24. We are having the two susceptance admittance as well. Okay, that's why it is shown over here. Is this clear? Now YIJ, that is your 1, 2 or 2, 3 or 3, 4 are the negative of the admittance connected between the bus I and bus J. If these two buses are physically connected with each other, if the two buses are not physically connected, for an example, bus number 1 and bus number 5 are not directly physically connected. You can see that bus number 1 is directly physically connected with the bus number 5. So the associated elements with the bus Y15, that is the Y15 and Y51 will be what? It equal to 0. Look at over here. Y15 is equal to 0. Y51 is equal to 0. Similarly, the 2 and 5 are also not connected. That's why it is equal to 0. 1 and 5, 1 and 4 are not connected directly. 1 and 3 are not connected directly. Okay. So that's why they are a 0. Okay. If there is no physical connection. If there is a physical connection, then it will be the negative of the admittance connected to the bus number I and bus number J. I hope this is clear to you. If you have any doubts, then you can drop your questions and queries in the comment section. We will solve it as soon as possible. Now, similarly, for an N bus power system, this is for a 5 bus power system. Now, if we are having the N bus power system, then this relationship equation 2.7 holds very satisfied. That is where I bus is equal to, it is N cross 1 vector. V bus will be equal to N cross 1 and Y bus will be equal to N cross N bus admittance matrix. Okay. Now, the further the elements of the Y bus matrix are calculated in same way as described above. In the previous section, in the previous example, we have seen. So far, we have considered the formation of YBUS matrix where there is no mutual coupling among the elements of the network. Yes, if there is, there may be a mutual coupling between the two elements. Okay, so we have, okay. Now let's do some of the MCQs. Now it has been asked which of this property is a property of YBUS matrix. Yes, tell me. Which of the properties of YBUS matrix? Is it a sparse matrix? Huh? Tell me. Is it is the diagonal elements are dominating? The off-diagonal elements are symmetric, a sparse matrix, and all of them. Yes, the correct answer is all of the above. We know that the diagonal elements are dominating. That is a Y11, Y12, 22. Y33 and so on. And off diagonal elements are always symmetric. That is Y12 is always equal to Y21. Okay. And it is a sparse matrix. That is the large number of elements are zero. Because we cannot have if we are considering the large power system, we cannot say that each of the node is connected with another node. Okay. That means it is not necessary that each of the node is connected to the another node. So it is always been possible that the matrix formed, the YBUS matrix is a sparse matrix. Okay, very having a low contents in it. Rest of most major are the zero. Now, next question is a power system. YBUS is a sparse because 90% of the off-diagonal elements are zero. mutual coupling between the elements are zero, less self admittance in the ornithogram. Just tell me, I've just recently explained you. The answer is this: 90% of octagonal elements are zero. I've told you, one of the two nodes are not necessarily being connected in a power system. If there is no mutual coupling between the transmission line and addition of wire admittance between the I and J will affect what? Yes. Try to solve this. Next is, if there is no mutual coupling between the transmission line and the addition of wire admittance between the I and the ground will change what? This is important. Understand the concept. Look at the diagram 5.7 and then we will see. Okay, 2.7. Try to solve these two questions as well. Okay, these are related to the ZBus algorithm. We will discuss them as well. But you can assume that how these are being done. Okay, thank you so much for your time. If you have any doubts and in this, then you can drop me in the comment section and I will solve it as soon as possible. Thank you.